From the back alleys and streets of Detroit comes a brand new show about music, comedy, art, and rebirth. This is The Box.
Hi, I'm Kirk Nolan, and welcome to The Box. And welcome to Detroit, the city that birthed me as an artist. This is where it all began, Detroit. This is where I left. I was so ready to escape this city. I wanted to just go as far as I could, and I wanted to become a big, big star one day. And in a blink of an eye, everything changed for me. So I'm back here again. The city that birthed me, that gave me life, that made me what I am as an artist today. To rise back up from the ashes, to rebuild myself like this city is doing every single day, and become the next version of who I left this town to become. So thank you for being a part of this magical journey, and welcome to The Box. Hi, I'm Kirk Nolan. Welcome to The Box. One year, an event happened to me so catastrophic that it changed my life forever, and it forced me down a road of annihilation. It's early morning, and I'm out walking Bugsy. I'm walking over near a church by my house, and it's always strange when I come over here early in the mornings because it's a lot like where I died on Christmas in 2015. And I would walk the grounds of this church and just to think and meditate. And they had these park benches like right here, like they have here, and I would sit on the benches, and they had these religious statues. I was walking my other dog, who's now since passed away. His name was Diesel, and I had a staph infection on my heart wall, and it had migrated to my brain, and it just was like a ticking time bomb that went off, and suddenly I went into septic shock that night. And if it wasn't for my dog Diesel, I don't think anybody ever, I mean, they wouldn't have found me. I wouldn't be alive today. Bless his soul, he's gone now, but he is the one who circled me all night and never left my side. And finally somebody from a house had seen me, or they seen him circling me, and they asked the mailman to go over and check it out, and the mailman found me naked laying in the snow at death's door, and they rushed me to the hospital and ended up saving my life. I'm so lucky to be here, and it was all due to that sweet little soul of mine. It's funny, when you're rebuilding your life and you're looking back on things, there's so many people who've come and gone in my life. There's one little soul that I miss more than anything in the world, and that is my buddy Diesel. He was just my pal. He was always there for me, loyal to the very end. In fact, this little guy right here is the one that stayed with me all night when I went for a walk one Christmas and went into septic shock. And they wouldn't have found me in the cold if it hadn't been for this little guy staying by my side, never leaving me and circling me until finally somebody saw him and called the police, and the police found me and called an ambulance and eventually saved my life. I was looking through some video today and I came across this sweet little video of my pal. I've been lucky to have a few great souls come into my life, but this was one of the most tender and sweetest of all. As I've been recording my life for over 10 years now, over a decade, I've been building. I didn't know I was doing this. I didn't know I was building an online documentary.
Right.
But I've been building an online documentary in increments of 1 minute pieces. I was a comedian most of my adult life. And I mean, I went all over the world. I headlined Las Vegas. And I don't remember a lot of that. I've lost a lot of it.
Sure.
And I do remember it because I have video of it.
Right.
And so what's
so you're
weird,
studying your own life.
I'm
yeah.
looking at two different lives. The one opportunity the universe gave me by sending me back was it really gave me a chance to be reborn.
I hate trying to get tagged for anything after 9/11. I got tagged for tweezers.
Anybody know tweezers are now deemed a lethal weapon by the FAA? Did you know that? You knew that? Well, why don't you pass the goddamn memo around? Thanks for letting me be the only asshole. Could you take a plane out with tweezers? How do you do that? Give me the plane! I will pluck the pilot's nose hair. I'm like the Wolverine, only littler. Sucks to travel now. You can't even use your cell phone on a plane. That kills me. We live with our cell phones every day to contact our loved ones. I was on a flight recently. Stewardess starts yelling at me, Sir! Turn your cell phone off. It'll disrupt the navigation of the plane and it'll take you down. Really? My cell phone's gonna take a plane down. Well, let's hope the terrorists don't find this shit out. Because evidently they've been packing bombs and suitcases for years, and all it takes is a sprint family plan. You know, they're gonna be getting out of plane going, don't make me die my cell phone! I've got unlimited nighttime and weekend!
Hello? Is this Brett? Is this Brett? Who is this? I'll tell you who it is.
It's me, the devil. You can't hide from me. I'm everywhere. I'm Beelzebub. I'm the Dark Underlord. Now call me on my cell. 666666. Bye.
And what's his name?
Adam.
His name is Adam.
Hey, Adam? Yeah, this is your neighbor calling. Your mom Paige told me to keep an eye on you. I can see your put back. I see your little ass popping up and down right now. Oh, is he on the phone right now?
No, he said
you look
nervous.
Oh, you need to call him. No, pull the number up. We'll call him from your phone. Then he'll answer. Then he'll answer. He won't answer my phone, but he'll answer yours, and then we'll get him. What's his name? Now I know you're home because I see your little ass popping up and down on her bed right now. My neighbor is, she's having me keep an eye on you. I don't know if you realize this because you're 18, you're stupid. So call me back. My number's 8-7-3. All right, I'll see you later. Bye.
When I first started doing comedy, I started at Mark Ridley's Comedy Castle. I remember I was working at a warehouse, and I was making a lot of money back then. I was making like $15 an hour. This is like in the 90s, you know what I mean? Yeah. So I was making a lot of money, full-time job, full benefits, the whole deal. All my friends and I, we were just living it up, right? We'd all gather in this little break room, this little office, and we're all in there in the cold in the winter. And I'm telling my jokes to all the guys, right? And one day the foreman comes in and he's hearing me tell jokes to everybody. And he finally looks at me and he says, you know what? Why don't you just shut up? You don't think we all had dreams? Yeah, guess what? You're gonna end up staying here like the rest of us because this is a good job and you're not gonna wanna lose it. Talk about wanting to keep me in the status quo, right? Uh-huh. And so just shut up, get back on your high-low, and let's get to work. And I remember I got on my high-low and I sat there for 20 minutes and I just thought, this is the moment. And this is the universe telling me, wake up now. Yeah. If you don't, you will be here for the next 30 years, right? Wow. So I remember he come back around and said, get to work. And I got off my high-low and I looked at him. And I never forget this. This is why I can remember this story. I've lost a lot of stories, but I can remember this story. He looked at me and said, I quit today. And he goes, you can't quit. And I went, you know what? I can do anything I want. And you're right. Thank you for telling me that, because if I don't leave today, I'll never leave. And I left that night and basically drained my bank account over the next months, you know, trying to like be a comedian. Yeah. But eventually I found my spot, comedy started to blow up, and next thing I knew, I started touring around the country and making a living being a comic.
Nuts, man. I watched Ripley's Believe It or Not the other day. Depressed me. I'm sitting there depressed. They had this woman on who had a cat who ate with chopsticks. Anybody see this? A cat, dude, eating with chopsticks. Cats eat with chopsticks back.
hit me. That's why Chinese people are eating cats. They discovered what we haven't figured out. Cats are only thumb away from taking over the world. That's right. Think about it. People already make their cats like they're humans. Go to a Halloween. You can get a costume for your cat. Dress them up to trick or treat. I saw a lady with a cat that was a bumblebee. Going, I'm telling you, pretty soon cats are gonna evolve. You're gonna come home one day. Your cat will be watching old James Bond reruns and Clint Eastwood movies. You walk in the door and the cat will be like, "How you doing, Mr. Bond? Let me introduce myself. My name's Pussy. Pussy Galore. And this is a 357 Magnum. Blow your head clean off. Do you feel lucky, Mr. Bond? Because if you don't, open up a can of tuna case. Guess who's using the litter box tonight, fat boy?"
Las Vegas. It's a place where I worked with comedian Richard Jenny, and I learned a very valuable lesson. Most people are lazy in life. The one thing Richard Jenny was not was lazy. He was a workhorse, and he was a perfectionist. He would spend hours before the show going through the lighting and the sound with the sound man. He would walk every corner of the stage yelling to the sound man, "All right, I need it turned up a little bit here. We need the bass down a little. Can you give me a little bit more on the tremble?" He taught me that attention to detail is everything. I was mesmerized by Richard Jenny. The guy made stand-up look effortless. So I remember sitting with Rich and we were talking one night. I said, "Look, Rich, when I watch your show, I see a lot of premises that really a lot of other comedians do. Yet when I watch you do those same premises, they are so much more unique and interesting and layered with so many jokes. I just wonder how you get to that point." And he told me something that I'll never forget. What most comics do is they find a premise and they start writing jokes. And at joke one or joke two or joke three, the comic thinks, "I found a joke. This is the joke. This is it, man. I am ready." And they're hitting the stage with joke one, two, or three. And pretty soon, you're gonna be building the whole act based on one, two, and three. To be the kind of comic that I wanna be, Kirk, I'm looking for joke 50. I'm looking for punchline 60. In fact, I'm gonna keep going until I exhaust every idea and every kind of way to look at this premise. These are the lessons I got from Richard Jenny. What Rich showed me was the power of hard work, of breaking a premise down, trying to find new ways to explore it and look at it, and try to find not just the first punchline, not the second punchline, but look for punchline 50. Richard Jenny, he's like jazz. He's like watching a great jazz virtuoso. I'm Kirk Nolan. Thanks for tuning in. I'll see you on the flip side.
I'm disturbed.
Of course I'm disturbed! We're all disturbed, and if we're not, why not?
You know, every time somebody takes their life by their own hand, it should be such a wake-up call for all of us. Because it just means that that person was in such pain that they were willing to do whatever it took to get themselves out of that pain.